This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
استراتيجية أمريكية جديدة في أفغانستان عنوان يكشف تفاصيله الرئيس الأمريكي.
The American president will reveal the details of the new strategy in Afghanistan a few hours from now. The new strategy, which took 2 months to prepare, calls for sending more American troops to Afghanistan. Obama acknowledged that his country's policy in Afghanistan for the past 7 years has failed. More details with Muna Abu Diab.
ملف أفغانستان من أصعب ملفات الرئاسية حقيقة جهر بها الرئيس الأمريكي.
The war in Afghanistan is one of the most difficult issues facing the White House. The American President Barack Obama acknowledged this reality on several occasions during the first few moments when he took over the White House. Obama described the situation in Afghanistan as a great failure. Now Obama is trying to end this failure using a new strategy, which he vows will bring the U.S. victory and enable it to get out of the Afghan hell.
The president will outline what he believes is the best strategy to face extremists in Afghanistan and eliminate their operations, not only in Afghanistan, but also in any other country in the world.
The objective is clear and specific, which is dismantling the Al-Qaeda organization and eliminating it once and for all. To achieve this mission, Obama will send 4,000 soldiers, in addition to the 17,000 other soldiers who were sent there 2 months ago. This raises the number of U.S. soldiers in Afghanistan to 59,000 soldiers. Obama wants to use these soldiers, who are armed to the teeth, to face the most dangerous threat on his agenda. This necessitates expanding the military operations to include the territories of next-door neighbor Pakistan, where Al-Qaeda and its leaders have established safe havens. These expanded military operations will require an additional 60% in funding, which already has reached $2 billion monthly. An additional $1.5 billion will be spent on humanitarian aid and development projects in Afghanistan annually. Obama is sending the outlines of this new American policy only a few days before the upcoming NATO summit, which will focus on the security deterioration in Afghanistan. Without a doubt, Obama is trying to remind his allies that the U.S. is still the strongest player in Afghanistan, and he is taking control of the situation, although he has been asking them for more aid and military support.
الحرب ضد حركة طالبان متواصلة على الأراضي الأفغانية.
The war against the Taliban movement continues in Afghanistan. 13 Taliban fighters were killed during clashes with Afghan forces and international forces in Lashkar, the capital of Helmand. This state is one of the Taliban strongholds.
أساسيا لنشاط طالبان في أفغانستان. خطط الإدارة الأمريكية لم تغب عن أجندة قادة تنظيم القاعدة وعناصرها.
Meanwhile, Al-Qaeda leaders responded to Obama's new strategy by modifying the agenda of the organization to deal with the additional American reinforcement that will be used to fight it. This news was reported by the New York Times in the U.S. The newspaper said that the leaders of the Taliban in Afghanistan and Pakistan have agreed to put their differences aside so that they can deal with the American reinforcement in Afghanistan. The same sources also cited security sources saying that new young members have been recruited to welcome the new American soldiers with a series of explosions.
جديدة ستتكفل باستقبال الجنود الأمريكيين الجدد بسلسلة من التفجيرات الإرهابية. ومنذ أقل من ساعة قتل 48 شخصاً.
Less than one hour ago, 48 people were killed and 70 others were injured when a suicide bomber blew himself up in the middle of worshippers in one of the mosques in northwestern Afghanistan. The attack, which was carried out during Friday prayers, led to the collapse of two floors of the mosque. An official in Khyber in Pakistan said that the death toll may rise to 90.
Staying with the U.S. president, he has announced that 21,000 troops will be deployed to Afghanistan. He says his top priority is to eliminate al-Qaeda and Taliban militants there and in neighboring Afghanistan, in neighboring Pakistan. Here is more.
Sacrificed for their future. U.S. President Barack Obama has announced his long-awaited strategy for Afghanistan. He focused on the continuation of a destructive war his predecessor began nearly 8 years ago.
I've already ordered the deployment of 17,000 troops that had been requested by General McKiernan for many months. These soldiers and Marines will take the fight to the Taliban in the south and the east. And later this spring, we will deploy approximately 4,000 U.S. troops to train Afghan security forces.
Obama's insistence on sending more troops to Afghanistan comes despite warnings that the arrival of more U.S. troops will spike violence in the country, and the civilians will bear the brunt of more violence in Afghanistan.
Many people in Afghanistan doubted if they send more troops in Afghanistan, it might leave more civilian deaths in this country.
Daily lives of thousands of people are being disrupted, be it because of air strikes, be it because of night raids, of suicide attacks, of the use of improvised explosive devices, or because of intimidation.
Afghans say America will never bring them peace as it did not in the past 7 years.
In the last 7 years, we haven't seen any significant benefits from America and other groups in Afghanistan, so I believe that the new strategy will not benefit us.
Obama also hinted that widely condemned U.S. airstrikes on Pakistan's tribal areas will continue.
The tribal regions are vast, they are rugged, and they are often ungoverned. And that's why we must focus our military assistance on the tools, training, and support that Pakistan needs to root out the terrorists.
Now it remains to be seen how the U.S. president's strategy for Afghanistan and Pakistan would work in light of the growing public opposition to the presence and the operations of foreign troops in the two countries.
The story of Iraq's borders with its neighboring countries is an endless one. This is a result of the problem of ongoing smuggling. However, the situation on the Saudi border is a different one. Our reporter Majid Hamid reports.
The story of Iraq and its neighboring countries regarding the borders is endless. This is due to the ongoing smuggling. However, the situation is very different on the Iraqi-Saudi border. The authorities consider the Riyadh-Baghdad border to be one of the most secure borders. The border experiences minimal smuggling operations, a result of the technologically advanced tools used, which includes the use of modern night cameras and barbed wire fences. These are measures that have been taken in order to fix the issue of border smuggling and also to help control the rugged terrain between the two countries.
We are cooperating. Cooperation and coordination from both ends is very helpful.
This waving Saudi flag is the only thing on the border, and there are no other border crossings between Saudi Arabia and Iraq, except for the Jadat Arar crossing, which is only used during the pilgrimage season. Iraqi authorities are scattered throughout the border, stationed in permanent observation towers, and positioned for ambushes in the valley.
Our authorities in this area focus on mobile patrols, stationed guards, and preparing for ambushes in the areas where smuggling takes place. Everyone is fulfilling their roles. The police stations on the border are doing a great job, and we have patrol cars monitoring the area.
The major factor behind the calmness in the border region is the distance of the nearest village, which is 100 kilometers away. This is in contrast to other areas that tie Iraq to its neighboring countries. While Al Arabiya was present in the area, the Saudi kingdom was renovating the border strip after heavy rain destroyed parts of the border that is overshadowed by silence, where the only audible sound is that of the desert birds. We hope that the border crossing between the two countries will open so that the economy can flourish. From the Iraqi-Saudi border, Majid Hamid, Al Arabiya.
The Oxfam International Relief Agency warned of the rapidly deteriorating situation that the hundreds of thousands of Somali refugees are facing in Kenya, describing a humanitarian catastrophe if no immediate measures are taken.
Oxfam said that the situation is dreadful in the three refugee camps that are located in the town of Dadaab in Kenya, where a quarter of a million Somali refugees live.
It seems like they try to escape from one thing and then they find another. The civil war and starvation in their country has made them seek refuge in a place where they thought they would have a better life. The thing they found was the exact thing they were trying to escape from. In Kenya, there isn't a war like the one in Somalia. However, the danger of death still follows the refugees due to the lack of health services, inadequate sanitation of water, and starvation, which has become a distinctive sign for Africans. The world was and is still unable to help save these people. The Oxfam International Relief Agency has published a report saying that a quarter of a million Somali refugees living in three refugee camps in Dadaab, northeast of Kenya, face a humanitarian emergency that can't be solved unless immediate measures are taken. The Oxfam agency stated that their delegates visited all three camps and uncovered the horrific situation, which is a serious public health crisis. There's also an outbreak of cholera among the residents, who live in shacks made out of tree branches. The problem is growing. The Oxfam report said that a quarter of a million refugees live in an area that should only contain 90,000 people. It is also expected that 100,000 others will arrive later this year. Kenya closed its long, porous desert border with Somalia about 2 years ago to stop the mass migration of civilians escaping the war. However, the attempt failed. Oxfam is now trying to convince Kenya to open up the border and to designate certain pieces of land to accommodate the refugees. It seems unlikely that the Kenyan government will accept this because of local poverty and because of the dehydration of the soil that has killed the crops and left the people close to death.
A private aircraft arrived at Baghdad International Airport. The flight was carrying more than 118 Iraqi refugees returning from the Republic of Yemen to Iraq for the first time.
Many people were anxiously awaiting for hours in the Ibn Firnas Square in front of Baghdad Airport. They were preparing to meet dozens of loved refugees who were returning home.
I have not slept for days.
I swear to God, I have not seen my nephew in 11 years. Being able to see him is a blessing from God.
I had a heart attack recently, but I still insisted to come to the airport. اعتراضات ومعوقات كثيرة كادت تمنع تصوير لحظة.
There were obstacles that prevented our camera crew from capturing the scene of the plane landing. Several described these obstacles as unnecessary security measures. However, people were still very anxious and excited to see their loved ones when they saw the plane in the sky.
I am so happy to come back to my country.
My love for my country is what brought me back. My land and its soil is what I missed.
I want to thank Prime Minister Nour al-Maliki, the Iraqi ministers, and the entire Iraqi government. I ask all my Iraqi brothers who are refugees in Yemen to come back to our country immediately.
No Arab president has ever done this for his people.
The Prime Minister's coordination office and its members gave those returning from Yemen a very warm welcome.
The Prime Minister wants to prove to his people that they are the most important part of the equation. Therefore, he sent them his private airplane.
Many expressed their fears and concerns regarding the possibility of facing difficulties upon returning. However, the representatives for the Ministry of Immigration reassured them and calmed them down.
The Ministry of Immigration has prepared an adequate foundation to support the returning families. They have prepared different programs and projects with the cooperation of governmental institutions and humanitarian organizations.
The Iraqi flight had many Iraqis returning from Sana'a to their land. This was like an advertisement campaign to let the people know that it is the season to return to Iraq. The returning refugees consider Iraq to be the most beautiful home. Samar al-Shimari, Al-Iraqiya, Baghdad. The cars of four Lebanese judges were subjected to gunfire in Badaro. The Prime Minister condemned the attacks, while the Attorney General, Yosef Mamari, is looking into the investigation.
For the second time in less than a year, the car of Judge Muhammad Talal Baydoun was attacked. This attack, however, was different because live ammunition was used. In the area of Badaro, near the Social Security Department, near the home of Judge Baydoun, the sound of gunfire was heard at 4 a.m. It turned out that the target of the attack was the car of Judge Baydoun, which had a license plate indicating that it was the vehicle of a judge. One bullet penetrated the two front windows of the car, which was parked next to the sidewalk. The two windows were completely destroyed. Security forces came to the scene, and in the morning, Judge Baydoun submitted a complaint against unknown attackers. The police opened an investigation and tried to obtain thumbprints. This was not the only attack of its kind. Security sources confirmed that the cars of three other judges were also attacked by gunfire in the same area. The judges are Hatem Madai, Peter Germanos, and Mir Nawamse. According to the same sources, the three judges took their cars to an unknown location without submitting a complaint. It is worth mentioning that the judge Talal Baydoun's car was subjected to a similar attack in the same area last year.
The General Assembly for the March 14th coalition considers Syrian President Bashar al-Assad's position to be important in that it may help to write a new chapter between Syria and Lebanon, reserving the issue of the Lebanese prisoners in Syrian jails.
The General Assembly for the March 14th coalition has confirmed that the presence of two bombs in a car in front of the home of President Amin al-Jamal means that the terrorist series of attacks against Lebanon and its independent leadership will continue. The Security Authority has requested that the results of the investigation be announced and that the Lebanese people be protected. After the meeting, the General Assembly criticized the words of Syrian President Bashar al-Assad regarding his refusal to acknowledge Syria's responsibility for the terrible relationship between Beirut and Damascus.
It is a very important decision that will help to write a new chapter in their relationship and work on a solid foundation between the countries. However, at the same time, the Syrian president has held on to his former position regarding the issue of Lebanese prisoners in Syrian jails. He also continues to insist on interfering in Lebanese matters and has made it clear that a Lebanese consensus is a condition for him to deal with Lebanon.
The General Assembly has re-emphasized their commitment to the position of the National Cedar Revolution and the political agenda that was adopted at the second conference that was held by the March 14th Coalition.
6 years have passed since the start of the Iraq War. The Iraq War seems to have disappeared from the national conversation. Have we forgotten about Iraq? And what stories about Iraq lack coverage in the U.S. media? Answers to these questions and more on Link TV's Mosaic Intelligence Report.
You may have missed it amid the AIG bonus furor. Even President Obama did not talk about it during his recent press conference. But last week marked 6 years since the start of the Iraq War. After 6 years and more than 4,000 U.S. casualties, the Iraq War seems to have disappeared from the national conversation. Violence in Iraq is down sharply when compared to 2006 and 2007 levels. However, it still continues at levels that most countries would find alarming. This week, at least 15 people have been killed and 30 wounded when a suicide bomber struck a Kurdish funeral tent northeast of Baghdad. Hours earlier, 8 people were killed and 10 wounded by a bomb west of the capital. Meanwhile, the condition of Iraqi refugees belies reports of falling violence and improved public safety in some Iraqi neighborhoods. The UN Refugee Agency estimates that more than 4.5 million Iraqis have been uprooted by the conflict, creating the largest refugee crisis in the Middle East since the founding of Israel in 1948. About 2.5 million are displaced within Iraq, while more than 2 million have taken refuge in neighboring countries, mainly Syria and Jordan. Part of our job at Mosaic News is to monitor more than 36 broadcasters originating from the Middle East. What we've been seeing lately on these different networks portrays a totally different image of Iraq when compared to what has been reported in the US media. I'd like to share with you a few of these stories reported by Iraqi and regional networks. Stories about poor health conditions, the spread of disease and poverty have been abundant. A recent story on Al Iraqiya TV portrayed Iraqis living off garbage dumps. Another one focused on children being abandoned by their parents at hospitals.
The child was brought here by a couple and has been living here for nearly 7 months. Before sunset on that day, we were shocked to find that the child was abandoned by the couple.
Both stories hardly represent the improvement in Iraqi lives we keep hearing about in the U.S. Then there were the two most disturbing stories. The first dealt with the effect of war on an Iraqi village where many of the newborns suffered from deformities due to the use of depleted uranium ordnance and other chemicals by U.S. soldiers, according to the report. The other, one of the most chilling stories I've seen, was about Iraqi women recounting the rape by U.S. soldiers in Abu Ghraib. Finally, the six-year anniversary was marked by a protest in Al-Basra, as reported by the Iranian network Al-Alam.
Today we are protesting in the province of Al-Basra and all around Iraq to request the release of the prisoners in the prisons of the U.S. occupying forces.
They carried signs condemning the occupation and requested the immediate withdrawal of British and U.S. forces from Iraq. I'm Jamal Dajani for the Mosaic Intelligence Report. To learn more about this program or to share your thoughts, visit us at linktv.org/mir. You can also read my blog on the Huffington Post.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic Video Podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you. This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.